Welcome back. Bill Clinton has said there's nobody outside his family that the Clintons love as much as our next guest. She's worked as Hillary Clinton's right-hand woman for 25 years and has been front row center to some of the biggest political moments of the century.
She was also immersed in a media storm when a sexting scandal sent her ex-husband, Anthony Weiner, to prison. She reveals her side of the story in Both And, A Life in Many Worlds. We are thrilled to have Huma Abedin joining us on the show today. Welcome, Huma.
Thank you so much, Hannah and Cynthia. I'm so excited to be on this show. And I'm so sad I'm not with you in person, but hopefully next time. Canada is very near and dear to my heart, and I hope all of my family is watching the show right now.
Aww. Yes, absolutely, for next time, Huma. Now, throughout your personal and professional life, you've been thrust into the spotlight against your will at times. Now you're choosing to step front and center with this book. What are you most eager to set the record straight on when it comes to your own story?
You know, I write in the book, I grew up surrounded by stories. I believed my father always believed I would be a writer. But I also think for the 25 years I've been in public that somebody else has told my story. And for me, it felt as though that meant somebody else was writing my history. And I wanted to reclaim that. And I am the daughter of two immigrant parents who came to this country. My father's from India, my mother from Pakistan. They left their families. They left everything behind to pursue education. Education was a religion for them. And they found the American dream here. I was born in Kalamazoo, Michigan. And I really, in part, wanted to sort of honor their legacy, honor the past. We spent our childhood traveling all over the world, including to Canada. We came to Canada every summer, which is why I'm especially excited to be talking to you. We'd go to Montreal or Toronto. And so it's really, it's been this extraordinary adventure, and I've loved writing the book and sharing my story.
Well, it's a wonderful story. We want to go back in time. You were only 21 when you entered the White House as an intern, but you hit the ground running. Just a few months into your time there, though, the Lewinsky scandal broke. This was the first of many challenges that you went through right by Hillary Clinton's side. So what did you learn about her from the way that she navigated that period?
Well, you know, I chose to share a lot of details about my experiences working for Hillary. And I did it, I tried to do it in a way that was more show, not tell. I'm not telling you what she was like or what she said. It was more showing people. I wanted to take people into the room, onto Air Force One, into the residence, the White House, and share some of the thoughts and feelings and experiences. And there was a tremendously difficult time in the Clinton administration during impeachment. For me, one of the reasons it was so significant is that all of these big milestone moments in that Whitewater investigation marked milestone moments in my professional growth. As you said, I was 21, and I didn't really understand. I mean, to me, when I walked into the White House, it felt like a cause. I didn't, you know, wasn't even sure I was a Democrat, frankly. I fell in love with the work. And so when the story broke, all I wanted to do was figure out how to, you know, protect her and do the best job I could so that she could deal with all the stress out in the world. But I will tell you, one of the things I hope people take away from the book was her sheer humanity, her empathy. I write a story in the book about a day where I thought I was going to be fired. And we have an experience at a dinner and she puts a plate down and says, "This isn't working." And I think that meant I'm about to be fired. And sure enough, we drive back to the White House and she calls me inside and said, "I just want to say I'm sorry for saying what I said. We're just all going through a very difficult time." To have that kind of environment, there's a whole chapter in the book called Hillary Land, and it is about the culture she has created and maintained for so many of us who've been lucky to be part of this club that we call Hillary Land.
Now, you worked your way up from intern to senior advisor, and you described the polar opposite of work-life balance. You took calls on your wedding day and also from your hospital bed while you were having contractions. Your mom even told Hillary Clinton that she was jealous of the time that you'd spent with her, that you spent more time with her than your own mother. You have gained so much from your job. But when you're reflecting back, do you think about the things that you've missed also?
You know, I think, you know, I open a chapter with something my father would tell me when I was younger, which is a good life is a balanced life. But that is certainly not what I pursued. I write the story of being at a family wedding and getting a phone call. And I had just started working at the White House and being asked, "Do you want to go to Argentina on behalf of the First Lady?" And I didn't even think about it. I said yes. And I called it my fork in the road. 22 years old and always in a hurry to get somewhere. I rarely thought of what I was leaving behind. And in hindsight, I realized I did not have a balanced life. It's what I tell all young women now when they ask me for advice about work and being successful at work is to find balance. Because I did miss out on a lot of things. I had an extraordinary career, an extraordinary life, but balance is good. And I think that was a good lesson that I learned.
You know, that's something I really appreciated in your book was the openness and the honesty there. You married Congressman Anthony Weiner in 2010, a wedding that Bill Clinton actually officiated. But the next year, you were dragged into a sexting scandal when Anthony accidentally posted an indecent photo online that was meant for another woman. You stood by his side then, as well as in 2013 when another sexting scandal surfaced. And, you know, it's very painful, obviously, as you can tell from the book. But, you know, I have to ask you because a lot of viewers might be wondering, why did you stay with him initially?
Well, you know, I think a lot of people look at my relationship with Anthony from a 2021 perspective. And so as I was writing this book, one of my colleagues said that, you know, one of the most common headlines about you from that period of time is, what is wrong with her and what is she thinking? And so I chose to put exactly what I was thinking in the book. And taking people back to that time, yes, Anthony and I were married in 2010. He was my first love. He was the first man I had ever been with. He was my first Valentine's Day date. And so for anybody who remembers that first, you know, flush of having that kind of relationship with somebody, that is who Anthony was for me. And we didn't just have this amazing life. It was, I thought, the perfect life. I write a chapter about waking up in Buckingham Palace. I'm a newlywed. I've just discovered I'm pregnant. I'm carrying his child. I wasn't even 12 weeks pregnant. So when the story broke, I was in such shock. I was in such trauma. I didn't understand. I didn't understand what was happening. I didn't understand the behavior. And as I write in the book, I certainly thought it was behavior he could just knock off, and which is why I did encourage him to run for mayor in 2013. And it is why I did stand with him at the press conference when everything fell apart. And I know I was judged for that. I know, you know, some people were unhappy about it and people wanted me fired, but I did it because I tried in every instance to make what I thought was the right decision for myself, for my child. I write in the book how close I was to my father. He died, and it was a trauma I carried for a very long time. And I wanted my son to have the opportunity to have a house with two parents in it. And I was going to do everything I could to give that to him. It took me a very long time, Hannah, to understand what he was dealing with, the mental health challenge, the inability to stop the behavior. I just thought, you know, somebody who's managed to control everything in her life, she goes to work, I know how to do things well, why can't you just stop?
Yeah, I mean, you know, of course, the public always weighs in on things like this, but particularly on things surrounding sex. And the public's asking why you stayed. You, in the background, were trying to figure out why Anthony did what he did. So he was, as you mentioned, eventually diagnosed and treated for sex addiction, which is a term that has since faced a lot of scrutiny. But when you heard that there was, you know, a kind of a deeper, you know, a diagnosis, did that help you make sense of what he did?
You know, it did take a long time. And as you know, as I share in the story, because I do think, and it is one of the reasons I chose to write the book, I went through something very difficult. Unfortunately, I don't think I'm the only woman or person who's gone through something like this. Unfortunately, betrayals, infidelity in relationships are just a fact, sadly a fact of life. And back then it was also we were in this new digital space. I mean, scandals were known certainly in politics and in other industries, but something about, you know, just social media engagement was entirely like the behavior was this big, what are you thinking and, you know, what is wrong with you? And I spent a lot of time saying, I don't understand. And actually, it took a very long time to understand the behavior, even as we were in therapy. It was, and I do believe a lot of this is Anthony's story to share, to tell about, you know, what he was struggling with and what he has to struggle with for the rest of his life. I tried to share the story insofar as it affected me. But if you're asking me, and you just mentioned that it's a term that there's some debate over, for somebody to engage in behavior that then is so self-destructive, that destroys not only their own life, their family's life, everything around them, that is behavior you can't control, to do it over and over again. And I spent years being angry and bitter and blaming him. And then I finally realized it took me to such a dark place. I was so angry. I was so bitter. And all it was doing was slowly, frankly, just killing me.
Yeah.
And so I did the hardest thing, which is I confronted it. I wanted to know the whole truth. We went through this process called a disclosure process. It's not for everyone. As I learned, Anthony, you know, said there's a, you know, taught me this term, suffering is optional. Pain might be necessary, but suffering is optional. I was suffering for a very long time. And we were able to get through the other side, and I'm glad we did. And I cannot tell you how many people I have heard from starting in 2011, but since this book came out, sharing their stories with me. Because this is a pain that other people do, unfortunately, have to deal with out there. And when particularly other women look at me and say, I don't understand what you're going through, what I want to say back to them is you're lucky because you're untouched. You don't have somebody in your life, a parent, a partner, a child, who has this self-destructive behavior. And I'm jealous of you. But those of us that do, we have to figure out how to live with these people for the rest of our life. And for me, it's the father of my child.
Yep.
And we're going to be in a relationship forever.
And so, Huma, we don't have a lot of time left, but I did want to get to this because, you know, Anthony's actions became criminal when he was found out to be sexting an underage girl. The FBI seized his laptop, and when they found classified emails on that laptop between you and Hillary Clinton, that's when James Comey announced that he was reopening the investigation into her emails. So Hillary Clinton, as we know, was cleared soon after, but you called Anthony and said, if Hillary loses this election, it will be because of you and me. Where do you stand with that today?
Well, I took people into that time. I mean, I was shocked. It felt selfish to even feel anything. It was an unprecedented announcement. And just to clarify, there was not classified information, but there were emails. But it felt as though it would alter the election in that moment and that whole week. And then for 2 days later, two days before the election, to say there's nothing here. It was horrible. I lived with that. I have to carry this for the rest of my life, but I had to work through the guilt that I had single-handedly, or that we had, you know, cost her the election. And an election this close, everything little thing mattered, and this was a big thing.
But Huma, you share this story so wonderfully, and we are wishing you the best. Thank you for joining us today and sharing your story.
Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you, Hannah. It's been a pleasure to be on with you today.
Everyone watching, the book is called Both And, you can find it everywhere now. Go get yourself a copy. We'll be right back.